نستعين به ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تبارك وتعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله تعالى فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار نسأل الله العزيز الغفار أن يجيرنا وإياكم من عذاب النار Praise Allah سبحانه وتعالى Thank you for the ni'mah of Islam and the ni'mah of Al-Quran One of the most tremendous ni'mah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon His servants Allah ta'ala honored this ummah by making us from the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam He honored us also by sending the Quran our way, the last revelation, the last book of legislation sent to mankind by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this in of itself is a tremendous source of honor and a tremendous ni'mah and a bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as we know, we talked about this before, that the Quran was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam through Jibreel alayhi salam, the angel Gabriel alayhi salam, that heard it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and recited it exactly the way he heard it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who in turn recited it to the Sahaba a certain way. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they heard it from the Prophet and they memorized it that way and they pronounced it the same way. And subhanAllah, because it was their language and since it was revealed in seven different tongues as the Prophet said that he received the Quran on seven alsun, seven different tongues. Because of the different tribes of the Arabs had different tribes that spoke in different ways. One of the examples that come to mind, the people of Yemen, for example, they had a way of saying things that the people that came from the south of the Arabic Peninsula said it differently. The example that just came to my mind is someone from close to the area of Mecca. He's a Bedouin that went to visit a king in Yemen. Then when he goes in to see the king, and the king happened to have his throne on an area that's high on a mountain. So the king told him, Thib. Thib. It comes from Wathaba. Wathaba. Most of the Arabs know Wathaba as a jump. But in this area of Yemen, Wathaba means to sit down. So he said to him, Thib. So the Bedouin is thinking, was this guy crazy? You know, it's like he's hesitating. Oh, yeah, oh king, what are you asking me? He said, Thib. He insisted. First time, second time. Then the third time he started thinking this is serious, this is a king. I'm in his kingdom, if I don't do what he says, you know, I'll be in trouble. Let me just do what he says. And then he jumped. he ended up killing himself because of this difference in the language. And similarly, many of the words that came in the Quran, some people even from Mecca didn't understand the first time before it was explained to them, because he was in different, from the dialect of different tribes. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu happens to be from the scholars of the Sahaba. He said, I did not understand the word Faqir. Allah says, Faqir is samawati wal ard. Faqir means someone who created something without a prior example. There's no blueprint that he followed. Because, for example, people that have created the airplane for the first time, they saw a prior example. They saw the birds, they saw the insects, they had a pretty good idea how the mechanism is supposed to work, you know, what to do and what not to do in order to fly properly. So they had a blueprint to follow. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there was nothing. There was no blueprint. Everything that He created, the idea and the things that were created, the idea of them and those things, was from scratch. There was no blueprint. That's what Faqir is salawatul ard, the creator, the one who created the heavens and the earth without a prior example. But Abdullah, Umar radiallahu, did not understand what it means until he saw two Bedouins fighting over a well that one of them had dug out. And they were quarreling to Umar radiallahu anhu. So he said to him, Ya Amir al-Mu'minin, Ana fatartuha. I'm the one that dug this well. Then Abdullah radiallahu anhu understood what Faqir means. So that shows you the diversity, the linguistic diversity that the Arabs had, and subhanAllah that the Quran came to cater to, subhanAllah. And that shows also the vastness of the vocabulary. I don't know if you remember a story that I said here in one of the lectures. This man wanted to marry this woman, but her father did not like him so much. So he wanted to tell him in a gentle way, in a nice way, you know, get lost. She said, yeah, no problem. But her dowry is for you to go and kill the lion that threatens our livestock. She said, okay. He got on his horse, he got his spear, went looking for the lion, found the lion, got into a battle, killed the lion, and brought his head to this man. He said, okay, here's the dowry. So the man was stuck, couldn't say anything, okay. So they got married. So the day that they got married, and it was customary for the Arabs on the day of their wedding to stand and give a khutbah. But a khutbah, not like ours here, that's supposed to last half an hour. Now he started from, let's say, they didn't have the clock back then, but let's say around 9 a.m. and finished at sunset. And the whole time, he spoke in poetry, everything rhymed that he said, and he was describing his battle with the lion. But in the process, he mentioned the word lion about 400 times, but every single time it was a different word. So there's over 400 names for the lion in the Arabic language, and this man used all of them in his poetry. That tells you the eloquence of those people when it comes to this particular language, and shows you the strength of this language, and shows you that subhanAllah, the Quran is a miracle from Allah. Now these people that had this kind of command of the Arabic language, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends a man to them who was illiterate, didn't know any poetry, and he was 40 years old. Now 40 is a pretty significant age when it comes to learning. You know, in general, when a person gets to 40 years old, even the time of learning is behind his back. I mean, this is in general terms. So, a man who's 40 years old, didn't know any poetry, did not know how to read or write, and he came to them with words that were a challenge for them. These people that control and they have absolute command of the Arabic language, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenged them in the thing that is in which they excelled the most. And it is the case with, if you notice the pattern with all the prophets and messengers, when Allah ta'ala sends miracles with them, He sends miracles that are pertaining to what their people excelled at. Like Musa alayhi salam, Fir'aun and his entourage, what did they excel at? Sorcery, witchcraft, magic tricks, things like that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends him with a staff. When he throws it, it turns into a huge snake. And according to the Mufassireen, according to the scholars of Islam, this was no ordinary snake. When Musa alayhi salam threw the staff, he himself got scared of that snake, because it was said that it was not a regular size snake. Forget those anacondas that we see, that they show us in South America. This is something even bigger. So much so that it was said that the first time that he threw his staff, Fir'aun got so scared that he peed himself and he ran back to his chambers. This is how tremendous it is, subhanAllah. So he brought something that is to the table that is stronger than those sorcerers had. So when he threw it, he was able to swallow everything that they had. Similarly with Isa alayhi salam, people of his time, they excelled at medicine and healing. They had, you know, the methods of healing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him with the ability to heal things that seemed incurable, like leprosy and blindness. And what is the most incurable thing? Huh? Exactly. That is the one that they will never find a cure for. Did he have a cure for it? Yes, he did. Subhanallah. Such is the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in sending the prophets and messengers in exactly what the people excelled at for it to be a proof of their prophethood and their messengership. Such is the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now the Quran, ya ikhwa, this is the miracle that is everlasting. This is the heritage of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he left behind, and we have to take care of it. We have to learn to recite it properly. Yes, brother.
Jesus, did he bring dead back to life for people to believe in his prophethood? What was the moral behind that?
Exactly that. To believe in his prophethood, because when he started curing people, and when he made that bird out of clay, blew into it, and the bird, you know, became alive and flew away, a lot of the Israelites said, "This is sorcery. This is not a prophet as he claims, but this is a sorcerer." So, did they ever hear of a sorcerer bringing someone from the dead? No. So that it had to be something even stronger. You know, subhanAllah, curing people from, even curing the blind was near impossible back then. But of course, the most impossible one, as everyone knows and everyone concurs, is when someone dies, that's it, he dies, there's no bringing him back. But subhanAllah, this was the biggest miracle of Isa alayhi salam for these people, these doubters, to come aboard and to believe. But the ones that had disease in their hearts still remained the same. And subhanAllah, that's how today we have Jews and Christians. The ones that didn't believe in Isa alayhi salam remained Jews. And the ones that believed in him became Christians. Now, unfortunately, both of them are misguided. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it clear, and his prophet made it clear, because they did not stay with that which their prophets and their messengers taught them, but they changed the information. Allah said in the Quran, يحرفون الكلمة عن مواضعه. They falsify, they commit forgeries. They take the book and they change things in it, they take away things in it. There are others that claim that they know the book, but they know nothing about the book of Allah. As Allah Ta'ala said in Surah Al-Imran, وَإِنَّ مِنْهُمْ لَفَرِيقًا يَلْمُونَ أَلْسِنَتَهُمْ بِالْكِتَابِ لِتَحْسَبُوهُ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَمَا هُوَ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَيَقُولُونَ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ وَمَا هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ وَيَقُولُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبَ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ وَإِنَّ مِنْهُمْ لَفَرِيقًا. From them there's a group, يَلْمُونَ أَلْسِنَتَهُمْ, they twist their tongues with the book so that they make you believe that it's from the book, but it's not from the book. And they claim it's from Allah. They claim it's from Allah, but it's not from Allah. And they say about Allah, that which is untrue, that's which is a lie, and they do it knowingly. قُلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبَ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. They know that they're lying about Allah, about the book of Allah. They know it, but they still do it. وَالْعِيدُ بِاللَّهِ. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from such a people. So, like I said, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is this tremendous heritage from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba that all of us have to take care of. And this is the purpose of this setting, so that we train ourselves to pronounce the book of Allah better and do it close to how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do and the Sahaba and the Tabi'een. And to mention real quick, and I mentioned this in the beginning of this series, the fact that, subhanAllah, up to the time where the Qur'an was being recited in the Arabic Peninsula, there were no issues with it. But when Islam propagated in non-Arab areas, and many entered Islam, then something appeared that we call al-lahm, al-lahm. Al-lahm in the Arabic language means a mistake. That means mispronouncing, making mistakes in pronunciation, which is normal when someone enters Islam, it's not his language. For them to pronounce correctly, it takes a while. So that is why the scholars of Islam put together this science called the science of Tajweed, so that people learn how to pronounce the Quran correctly. So inshallah, this is what this series is about, learning the Tajweed and learning to pronounce the right way. Now, the last time, we started with the ahkam of a noon, sakina, and a tanween. You were here, right? So we did the first hukm, which is the idgham. And the first hukm, the first rule of Tajweed, whenever you have a noon with sukun, or a tanween, and six different letters come after it, then you pronounce the noon naturally the way it is supposed to pronounce. You show it. And those letters are Hamzun, Faha'u, Thumma Ainun, Ha'u, Muhmalatan, Thumma Ghainun, Kha'u. These six letters. Hamza, Ha, Ain, Ha, Ghain, Kha. Whenever you have one of these six letters come after a noon with sukun or a tanween, then you pronounce it noon normally. Can you give me an example? Give me a Quran, please. Can you give me an example? Yeah. Give me an example of the hamza. فمن أظلم جزاكم الله خيرا ينأون عنه من آمن إلى آخره. Can you think of an example of ها؟ ومنهم منهم من يستمع إليك. يلا أبو محمد طينا give us an example. نون سكون and ها from anywhere in the Quran.
نون
سكون
and ها.
Yeah. يهلك من هلك عن بيته. We want your example, not his. Repeat. من هلك. Yeah, but it's a hat after the normal sukun, it has to be a hat. إن هو إلا وحي يوحى ما شاء الله جزاكم الله خير. العين من عمل صالحا من عند الله. So basically the point here, these six letters, as we mentioned, you show the note, you show it clearly. Why do we say that? Because in the other ahkam that are coming, you have to either conceal the noon, or you have to put it inside the letter that comes after it. So, like for example, the second hukm, which is al-idgham. Al-idgham is to put something inside another thing. In the case of a noon sakina, tanween, whenever one of the six letters of idgham come after the noon with sukun, then you put the noon inside of it. What are the letters of idgham? يغبلون نعم والثاني إلغام بستة أتت يغبلون عندهم قد ثبتت. So يغبلون ياء راء ميم لام واو نون. These six letters, whenever they come after a noon with sukun and or tanween, you're supposed to do إلغام. You put it inside that next letter. Now it's split into two categories, right? What's the first category? Idgham with ghunna, which is what letters? Yanmu, and the word yanmu. Ya, mim, nun, waw. Example, وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَهُ وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرَّيَّرَ. So you have noon or tanween, yeah, after it. You don't say شَرَّيَّرَ, you say شَرَّيَّرَ. So you put the noon or tanween inside of the yeah, and you give it two harakat, meaning that you spend 2 seconds on it, doing a ghunna. This is the ghunna. It's a sound that comes from al-khayshum, from the nose. And it was said by the scholars that it is the sound of a female deer that lost its baby or its calf. It makes that sound. So this is where they identify this particular sound of ghunna. وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَى. This particular sound. يَنْمُ نُون, نُون with نُون. Now, remember we said that in the Quran and in the Arabic language in general, that whenever those two, when the same letter, the first one has sukun and the second one has the fatha dhamma kasra, they meet, we do idgham every time. We put one inside the other. And subhanAllah, if you remember, we said even the letters that have shadda, this is a result of idgham, because the shadda is something that the Arabs came up with to make the language flow. Like for example, وَالصَّافَّاتِ صَفَّا. This word was صَ has shadda, فَ has shadda as well. And originally these two are وَالصَّافَّاتِ وَالصَّافَّاتِ, they put them together, it became وَالصَّافَّاتِ. Fafati, fa, f, fa, fa, put together and became one with shadda. So the first part, the first four letters, yanmu, they all, you do idgham with a ghunna, with that sound. The second category is idgham with no ghunna, la and ra. An example, فَمَلَّمْ, so there's no. So some people, they'll say فَمَلَّمْ, and this is completely wrong. فَمَلَّمْ, there's no ghunna in it. There's absolutely no ghunna. Huh? No, فَمَلَّمْ. The noun disappears inside the lam. You jump straight to the lam, but you don't يبت دوغنا افتو حركات من ربك بالراء من ربكما من ربكما يا موسى who can give me another example with noon and ra after noon with sukun and ra يضحي يا أخي ما شاء الله where do you fish that one it's good it's great ما شاء الله you dug deep when you throw the pole right there the sanara you throw it really far ما شاء الله good who can give me an example يا محمد الله يديك محمد يا محمد انت شو نايم غفور رحيم تنوين and الله غفور رحيم as you notice there is no هنّة so inshallah لا أطيل عليكم كثيرا don't want to make it too long let's recite a little bit inshallah تعالى so that everyone can go home and relax inshallah تعالى including me inshallah so when did we stop last time just so you know, the ones that just joined us for the first time, we started with Al-Fatiha. We spent three different halaqats with Al-Fatiha, to correct Al-Fatiha. Believe it or not, most people had problems with it. Then now we're working on the small surah, which is Amma, to get our recitation and our pronunciation to be strong. Then we can move on, inshallah ta'ala, to a bigger surah. إن شاء الله تعالى أين توقفنا يا عبد الرحمن تكافؤ شو كان الصعوبة هي الصعوبة اللون المشددة في آخر كلمتين ما أعطيتها حقها فأعيدها When I corrected here is النون which شدة you have to give it two seconds وهن ميما ثم نونا شددا وسمي كلا حرف هنة بدا ثم لتسألن يومئذ عن النعيم تفضل the vowels the right way. So it comes out تعلمون 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 but Quran you need to hear everyone clearly. كلا سوف تعلمون. You did it again. كلا سوف تعلمون. لا لا ستعلمون.
كلا سوف تعلمون.
أسفل.
ثم كلا سوف تعلمون. كلا لو تعلمون علم اليقين لترون الجحيم ثم لترون
يومئذ. ده همزة صعب لك عين الليل. يومئذ
عن النعيم.
Do you know why? You know what happened? Again, most people that are, I noticed that, you know, English speaking people. Whenever they know that there's a عين coming, subconsciously they start tightening up. السلام عليكم. You know, because they know the عين is coming. So you hear that, they don't say As-salamu alaykum. When they get to the end, they tighten up. They tighten up right before. As-salamu alaykum. So he heard, he knows the ayn is coming, so the hamza, his hamza sounds like a ayn. Yeah. You see? ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ. عن النعيم. أبا محمد. يا أبا محمد أتحفنا أتحفك الله. مقادير. أيوة. أخلص الكسر. مقادير.
حتى زرتم المقابر.
زرتم المقابر.
حتى زرتم المقابر. كلا سوف تعلمون. كلا.
ثم.
كلا سوف تعلمون. كلا لو تعلمون علم اليقين.
لترون
الجحيم ثم لترونها عين اليقين ثم لتسألن يومئذ عن النعيم.
عن النعيم.
لا.
Two seconds on the note. عن النعيم.
عن النعيم.
أحسنت. وعبد الرحمن.
وما أدراك ما هي نار حامية.
we're doing in general, we're reciting through the way of a طيب, of a shot of a طيبه, not a shot of beer. So we're doing four seconds on المد. If مد ألف ياء واو ياء and همزة after it, give you 4 seconds every time, but whether it's in the same word or in two words, okay? وما أدراك ما القارعة.
صوت النون
يختفي يدخل في الراء. عيشة راضية، عيشة راضية.
فوسقنا بهم جمعا إن الإنسان لربه لكنود
لكنود إن الإنسان
إن الإنسان لربه لكنود
we need to hear the qalqala at the end. Because if you say kanud, kanud, it's not a real dal. We have to hear the qalqala. So say ada, ada, uda, 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 kanud. There you go. De. Kanud. Yes. أفلا يعلم إذا بعثر ما في القبور. إن ربهم بهم يومئذ لخبير. الشفوي وجدتون إن شاء الله بعد هم بهم that means you conceal the mean, okay, conceal the mean and you do a ghunna ftuha of almost like you don't pronounce the mean but you leave enough space for a piece of paper to go in and out, okay, that's the space that you leave and then you elongate it for 2 seconds. هم بهم, I'll say هم بهم, هم بهم. خلينا معاني الوقت إن شاء الله كمل الكلام إن شاء الله. هو الكلام عامة عن الخيل, عن الخيل أيوة إن شاء الله صحيح بعدين, بس هذا كلام عن الخيل, خيول العربية, خيول الحرب يعني. ضبحا قدحا
قدحا فالمغيرات صبحا فأخذنا به نقعا ووسطنا به جمعا
جمعا جمعا
فوسطنا به جمعا إن الإنسان لربه
إن الإنسان أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. الحمد لله رب العالمين.